Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Anil Shiratti, professor and consultant. So in today's session 2, we will continue with module 1. So in today's class, I will be covering two stuffs. One is impact of design for manufacturing and assembly. A case study we will be discussing. And then what are the principles of design for manufacturing and assembly. Okay, in details we will be studying that. So let's start with the first part. So before going to the impact of design for manufacturing, we just refresh what is design for manufacturing and what is design for assembly. So for design for manufacturing is concerned with reduction of overall part production cost. Okay, so we have to minimize the complexity at the part level or component level related to its manufacturing, and we have to use as much as possible common manufacturing process and common tools. Okay, in case of a design for assembly, we are mainly concerned about reducing the overall cost and time for the product to be get assembled. Now in this case, we have to minimize the number of parts to be assembled and also complexity dealing with assembly operation. Now the product part may be complex at the individual parts can be complex is allowed, but when they are going in the assembly, it should not make assembly process very complicated. Okay, so whenever we are designing any product, we have to think how I can reduce the manufacturing cost, how I can reduce the assembly cost without compromising on the quality of the product. So let's see first example. This is a rectal assembly from Texas Instruments. Okay, so you can see in the first part is almost more than 45 parts are there. Okay, so you got this shaft, you got a retaining ring, you got a coupling, you got few screws here, brackets. This is the main base plate. This is the upper sub assembly, which consists of 9 spring set. Okay, then retainer springs are there. Okay, so you can see there are so many parts. Definitely this will take more time to assembly also. Okay, now when they went through design for manufacturing assembly, did all the analysis, and they came with the new design. Okay, so you can see after process following the procedure for DFA, they made one bracket, that is the base plate with a housing. Okay, one shaft, and this is the upper assembly with only 2 springs, 1 cam arrangement, 1 bushing. So even not only this, number of parts has reduced, even the parts to produce at a faster rate. So what happened because of this impact of DFA? Let's pass to be designed, documented, revised. Okay, so what happens is designing cost is reduced, documentation to maintaining so many parts reduced, any revision has to be done, as the number of parts reduced, only for few parts I have to do the revision. Also less bill of material cost, so pass to receive, inspect, store, handle has reduced, because parts have reduced so heavily. So from 40 to 45 parts it has reduced to 10, so I have to maintain very less component in inventory. Okay, also as the number of bill of material is less, what will happen, even the number of parts to make assembly has reduced. Next is less labor energy to build the product. Okay, as the number of parts are less, get into customer hand faster, because faster to manufacture, faster to assemble. And next, complexity is heavily reduced. Okay, which will again decreases the time for assembly or manufacturing. Simple assembly instruction, and also quality has improved a lot if you see the design. And next, as overall this has reduced the cost, we will get higher profit margin and more competitive in the market, because your cost is reduced, also the time to manufacture is reduced very heavily. So the major takeaway with this case study is this. So generally what they say, fasteners typically account for 5% of bill of material from cost point of view, but yet they contribute 70% of the labor cost. So you can see, even the simple nuts and bolt and fasteners, which are just a 5% of the cost of the complete part to be assembled, but they take more than 70% of the labor cost. Okay, so this will lead to more assembly time and also the cost. So always we have to remember the assembly time also should be reduced heavily. So how this is done? First, they have estimated the manufacturing cost, then they reduce the cost of the component, they reduce the cost of the assembly, reduce the cost of supporting production, and then they consider the DFMA decisions on the other factors. Now, what is actually designed for manufacturing and assembly? What you understood from this one, a set of guidelines developed to ensure that a product is designed so that it can be easily and effectively manufactured, assembled with a minimum effort and time and the cost. Product design using DFMA principle should have higher quality and reliability than the others. And DFM also ensures that the transition from the design phase to production phase is smooth and rapidly as possible. Because we know we have to reduce the production time. If we are putting good efforts at the design phase itself, the amount you are spending and doing any changes or dealing during the production will get reduced heavily. And it is a concurrent engineering team approach. Okay. The best result occur when the DFMA is used in the product conception stage itself. So what it is saying is, during design phase itself, if we are using the DFMA principle, what will happen? It will decrease the time for product to get manufactured. So the cost when we are doing the design is less compared to the manufacturing time. The cross-functional team works towards minimizing the number of components, manufacturing step, operation while designing the proven manufacturing facility or capability. So what it says is, during the design phase itself, the production people has to be also consulted, okay, or they should be also on board. So what will happen, they can immediately tell you, okay, this design may take more time for production or more cost is there, okay, or I have to make more jigs and fixture, or if it is possible to make small changes like this, what will happen, my cost will for production or time will get reduced. So immediately a designer, if he's happy with from feature point of view or his functional point of view, he can make the changes immediately. Okay, now let's go to the principle of design for manufacturing. So there are more than 12 principles. So I'll just list down this principle first, and then we will go through each principle in detail. First is minimize the part count. Number of parts should be reduced. Make part multifunctional. Next, design the part to be self-aligning and self-locating. Use static assembly. Okay. Then ensure the ease of handling from bulk. Eliminate interfaces. Design the parts that cannot be installed incorrectly. Okay. Maximize the part symmetry. If possible, make part absolutely asymmetrical. Use standard parts and hardware. Simplify and optimize the manufacturing process. Encourage modular assembly. Okay. So these are the few principles of design for manufacturing and assembly. So we will go principle one by one. So first principle, minimize the cost of the parts. Number of parts should be reduced. So the final cost of the product is directly proportional to the number of parts. As the number of parts is reduced, the product quality and reliability typically increases. Okay. Next, a simple test to determine if the part can be eliminated. Okay. Now you can see, this is the first design consists of 11 pieces. Now this is the third design which consists of 3 pieces. So what happens? The number of parts got reduced. Okay. So because of that, product quality has increased, reliability typically increases. Okay, so if even one screw is not tightened properly or have some problem, this will not function properly. So see, the new design is more better. So how you can do using the principle of DFMA? You have to ask these three simple questions. Must the part move relative to other part in performing its function? Next, must the part be made of different materials? Must the part be a separate component? Whether it is really needed? Okay. So all this, if you go through these questions, you can come up with a new design. So if the answer to this three questions is no, then the possibility of combining the parts with other should be considered. Okay. So this is a example of how I can minimize the part from 11 to 3 pieces. Next is the make parts multifunctional. So all of you know this one. This is a Swiss knife. So what is its function? It can be used for multiple purpose. You can cut your nails, you can open the cork of a bottle. Okay, you can use it as a scissor. Many functions. Okay, so your product should be like that. Multiple functions of different parts or products can be combined into a single product. It will have a better market value. Next is design the parts to be self-aligned and self-locating. Self-aligning parts can be placed into exact location with no adjustment required. This makes assembly easier, faster for the assembly workers. Examples of self-locking feature include projection, indentation, chamfers, mold, keyways, etc. So let's see the first this example. So you can parts can hang up. So this is a simple like this part, and what I'm doing is we are putting a spring here. So you can see a spring can stuck here. So a simple chamfer at this place, what will go when the spring you put simply comes and sit to this location. So a simple chamfer will solve all the issue of self-align. Similarly, parts must be released before it is located, making it difficult to align. So here even some chamfer is there. So you can see alignment is going like this. Now even a small chamfer at the pin side, it can fit properly. Okay. So here a pin is not chamfered, so it will have problem. So even if you that also get chamfered, even the bottom parts get chamfered, they can fit very easily. So this is called self-aligning and self-locking system. Next, use stacked assembly. Okay, assembly operation should use not fight or gravity. One way to do this is to design the parts for stacked assembly, that is assembling component from bottom to top. Recovers less orientation of the component, which speeds up the assembly process. Not using gravity generally requires the use of additional tooling and friction. So this is an example. This is an exploded view of one electronic assembly. So you can see how the parts got assembled. So this parts goes first, second, third, fourth. It will go one above the other, and you will get the final assembly. So this stacking assembly sequence will help to reduce the assembly cost and the time. Next is ensure the ease of handling the parts from the bulk. See, many parts will be given in a bulk, okay, if you are using more quantity. So parts should be designed with handling in mind. So see, this is an example, not like this, because it gets stuck. So if you have like this design, it may not get stuck. Similarly here, okay. Otherwise what happens, if like this parts are there, another part is like this, it will get stuck one inside the other. Okay. Similarly for this ring or this clip. Okay. Unless and otherwise there is a requirement from function point of view, you can do it, but otherwise you have to avoid like this type of design. Okay. Next is component should not be tangled or nested together when mixed together in a box or a bin. So design parts should not parts so that nest or in tangle. So locking angle, you can do this one. Increase the locking angle, again it will have less. Change the shape, You can see how much the angle. Decrease the angle, what this will happen. Now these parts can be easily tangled easily. This part cannot tangle. Next is minimize the potential for becoming tangled or stuck together. So you can see if the spring is like this, it can stuck in between. But this is a better design. Okay. Similarly here, if this pin is completely locked, it will be a better design compared to the other one. So this will ensure ease of handling if the parts are in bulk quantity. Next is handling difficulties. So we have to see size. If size is very small, again the problem with handling with hand will be. If it is very sharp, it is very dangerous. Okay, it should not be flexible enough also, so that it's while even transporting or taking it, it should not break, and also it should not be much slipperiness. So during design phase itself, you have to think all these four parameters, that is size, sharpness, flexibility and slipperiness. Okay, so this is related to material handling or the equipment handling. Okay, next is eliminate the interfaces. So interface increases the cost of the assembly. Each interface doubles the amount of information required and increases the overall assembly time. Example, two set of dimensions, two set of tolerance, two set of interface features, assembly labor, assembly material, etc. So let's see this example. See, one part, the down one, then the second part, and then you are screwing together. So what happens? I have to give two dimensions and two set of dimensions and tolerance. So there is some interference fit is there. So this part should be have less, let's say this dimension compared to this one, so that they can easily fit. Again, when you are screwing, chances are there it may be have loose, it may lose its functionality. So like this interference fit should be avoided. So I can go for like this design. So in a single part, either I can get it machine or I can directly forge it, depends upon what is my requirement. Next is design the parts that cannot be installed incorrectly. A small use physical obstruction to stop the component being fitted in the wrong place or in the wrong round. So you can see this example. Okay, so what is this one? This is the down plate. Okay, and this top plate will come and fit here. Okay, now our objective is this angle, whatever you are showing in the front, that should be at the let's say the front side, and this should come at the back. Now if this both the holes are of same size, the person can reverse it. So this part may come this side. Okay, this vertical part may come back side instead of in the front side. So what the designer did is this hole, he has made it small, and this hole he's made it big. So what will happen? We have a simple observation, or during the assembly phase itself, a worker may not do any mistake. So this approach is called as Pokayoko. So mistake proving. Okay, proofing. So a small design change will help the faster the assembly, and also any wrong doing will get eliminated. So this is the design part that can be installed incorrectly. The maximize the part symmetry if possible, and make sure the parts absolutely asymmetrical. So let's see this example where we are having shaft. Okay, so make the component fit either way around whenever you can. Ideally parts can be have rotational or end to end symmetry. So let's see this first shaft. You can see there is a chamfer at one end. Okay, there is no chamfer at the other end. But if you see the second shaft, chamfer at both. Now whenever this shaft is used, you can use from either side. Either I can insert from left or right. But suppose you want to insert wherever the chamfer is there, it is better to do the chamfer at the both sides. So it can be used, inserted or fitted from both sides. Okay. So this will not increase the cost much during manufacturing time, but during the assembly time, it will reduces the time very heavily. Next is this irregular sized
spaced holes forces the worker to figure out which way it fits. The addition of a flat side or a similar feature helps to achieve correct orientation during the manual assembly. Okay, so you can see this is asymmetrical. We don't know which side. See, this distance is less than compared to this distance. So suppose this part has to be fitted like this, and if I rotate, chances again are more. So a simple cut at this part will help me to fit in the part at faster. The next is use of standard parts and hardware. Standardization require increased communication between the design teams. Okay, reduce the number of tooling required for assembly and lower the assembly cost. In order to facilitate the use of standard parts, the design team should utilize various resources such as preferred part list, standard part manual, vendor catalog, trade magazines, etc. So you can see these are the car manufacturer. These are the two different models, but if you see the bumper is same, the back bumper. Similarly, if you see the front bumper, they are using the same, but the both are of different models. So similarly, if you are going even in the cars, let's say you are going for a Maruti, maybe one version of Maruti, let's say Swift and Desire, both the version will have same engine. Okay, so they are maintaining same engine, so overall cost for them is decreased because they are procuring more engine. Similarly, from maintenance point of view and future repair point of view, they, the workstation, a single worker who is having knowledge of that specific engine, he can handle both Swift car and also he can handle Desire car. So not only after the sales, also they are taking care of the maintenance point of view. Next is simplify and optimize the manufacturing process. Simplification and optimization of the manufacturing process reduces the recurring direct and overhead cost. Use processes that are easily controllable. Avoid where possible processes that are difficult to control and perform like operations simultaneously. So this is a simple operation done on vertical milling machine. So you can see it will take more time to do the setup. Okay, setup time will be always more compared to the whatever the operation time. So once the setup is done, you to see to that even the milling operation is happening, plus drilling and some few more operation should be done on the same machine. Okay, so what will happen, this will reduces the cost very heavily because the setup time is very much important. And if you are doing drilling on one vertical milling machine, then milling on one, what will happen, it will chances of doing wrongs will increase, because every time you are going and doing the setup at other machines, setup time is increased, also probability of making mistakes is increased. Additionally, we should avoid wherever possible process that are difficult to control, for example welding and brazing. The last one, encourage modular assembly. Okay, modularize multiple parts into a single sub assembly simplifies the assembly operation and make problem identification easier by reducing the number of parts. Modular assembly also simplifies inventory and improves the maintenance and serviceability. By designing the part as a separate self-contained modules, disassembly time is reduced, fewer tools are required, and overall repair time is reduced. So this is a simple example. Some battery is there, so you got six I can say caps which should be fitted here. So instead of that, what they are doing is they have sub-assembled into three caps, so the overall assembly time will get reduced. Okay, even the maintaining for them inventory
is reduced.
This is a simple example of tape where they are using six batteries. So when I am doing the assembly, what happens, one battery goes, second battery, then because of the spring it may come out. So instead of this, if I use a simple modular system where all batteries are fitted in a single module and then it goes and fits here, it will reduce my time to assembly heavily. Okay, so in today's class we saw a case study of impact of design for manufacturing on the product, and then different principles of design for manufacturing and assembly which will should be considered so that the overall time to manufacture and cost to manufacture, time to assembly and cost to assembly is reduced. So if you have any questions, you can contact me on the email ID given, and also contact or text me on my mobile number.